Part 1. Read these words. See, she, sue, shoe, sip, ship, us, ash, rush, rush, pus, push, sheet, show, washing, Swedish, shawl, check machine, English, shop, show, special, shrunk, shut, finish, children sure, wish, demonstration, television, treasure, garage, casual clothes, Peugeot, Asia, measuring tape, an unusual collision, sips, chips, sheep, ship, cherry, cherry, shop, chop, cast, catch, wash, watch, children, butcher shop, Mrs. Crutch, check, chum, chops, much, chaser, shoulder, which, cheaper, a delicious chicken, choose, children lunch, orange juice, rich child, which job, village, jail, watch, chain, college, church, large, gentleman, large, cherries, huge, jam jar, how much, cheese, teach, German. Part 2. Read this text. More US adults who do not already have children are saying they are unlikely to ever have them. A new Pew Research Center survey findings that could draw renewed attention to the risk of declining birth rates for industrialized nations. Experts are concerned that the US birth rate, which has declined for the sixth straight year, may not fuel enough population growth on its own to keep the future economy afloat and fund social programs. Women between the age of 18 to 49 and men between 18 and 59 who said they are not parents were asked the question, thinking about the future, how likely is it that you will have children someday? In October, 26% of them said it is very likely, a 6-point drop from 2018 when 32% answer very likely. Meanwhile, the share of Americans who answer not too likely in 2021 grew to 20%, compared to 16% in 2018. When asked for a reason, 56% of childless adults who said it is not at all or not too likely they will ever have children said it's because they just don't want them. That's a change from in 2018 when 63% of childless adults in this category said it was because they had no desire for children. This time around, 43% cited other reasons including medical issues, economic or financial reasons, and lack of partner help out of the quicksand. How the child care crisis is keeping moms out of work. When the pandemic led to a lack of child care, single mothers like Denise Tyre were left in the lurch. Unable to work, coupled with the recent release of federal demographic data, this poll points to a long-term evolution in parenthood trends in the United States. The spiraling post of child care, health care, and education, along with global instability including the coronavirus pandemic and climate change, could all be contributing to a broader change in attitudes to marriage and priorities in life. U.S. birth rate falls to its lowest level in decades in the wake of pandemic. In April, the Census Bureau reported that in the last decade, the U.S. population grew at the second slowest rate for any 10-year period since the nation's founding. Pew surveyed 3,866 parents and non-parents online in late October as part of a broader study of nearly 10,000 U.S. adults known as the American Trends Panel Survey. Those who said they have no children were asked to rate their desire to have them in the future, while adults who said they already have children were asked to rate their likelihood of having more. The same question were asked in a similar poll Pew conducted in late July to early August 2018, enabling a comparison of trends over time. There was no difference based on gender in the responses among parents and non-parents. According to Pew, men and women are equally likely to say they will probably not have kids or more kids in the future. There was a difference based on age. However, with adults in their 40s far more likely than younger adults to say they are unlikely to have any or any more children in the future. The Biden administration have attempted to tackle some of the roadblocks to higher fertility through its roughly $2 trillion Build Back Better bill, which recently passed the House and is now moving to the Senate. The bill includes funding for universal pre-K as well as the first national paid family and medical leave program. She was walking lazily, for the fierce April sun was directly overhead. Her umbrella blocked its rays, but nothing blocked the heat. The sort of raw, wild heat that crushes you with its energy. A few buffalo were tethered under coconuts, roasting the parched verges. Occasionally, car went past, leaving its tread in the melting pitch like the wake of a ship at sea. Otherwise, it was quiet, and she saw no one. In her long white Sunday dress, you might have taken Jeannie Nerlin for 14 or 15. In fact, she was 12, a happy, uncomplicated child with a nature as open as the red hibiscus that decorated her black, waist-length hair. Generation early, her family had come to Trinidad from India as overseers on the sugar plantation. Her father had had some success through buying and clearing land around Rio Cristalino and planting it with coffee. On the dusty verge 20 yards ahead of Jeannie, a car pulled up. She had noticed it cruise by once before, but she did not recognize it and could not make out the driver through its dark windows. Themselves as black as its gleaming paintwork, as she walked past it, the driver's glass started to open. "Hello, Jeannie," she heard behind her. She paused and turned, a slight color rose beneath her dusky skin. Rafi Kirjani was tall and lean, and always well-dressed. His black eyes and large white teeth flashed in the sunlight as he spoke. Everyone in Rio Cristalino knew Rafi. Jeannie often heard her unmarried sister talk ruefully of him, of how if only their father were alive and they still had plans, one of them might marry him. And then they would squabble over who it might be and laugh at Jeannie because she was too simple for any man to want. "How do you know my name, Rafi?" she asked with a thrill. "How do you know mine?" "Everyone knows your name. You're Mr. Kirjani's son." "Right. And where you going, Jeannie?" She hesitated and looked down at the ground again. "To chapel," she said with a faint smile. "But Jeannie, good Hindus go to the temple." His rich, cultured voice was gently mocking as he added with a laugh. "Or maybe the temple punis aren't your taste in color." She blushed more deeply at the reference to Father Olivier. She did not know how to reply. It was true that she liked the young French priest with his funny accent and blue eyes. But she had been going to the Catholic chapel for months before he arrived. She loved its cheerful hymns and its simple creed of one God. so different from those miserable Hindu gods who squabble with each other like her sister at home. But added to that, the vulgarity of Ravi's remark bewildered her because his family were known for their breeding. People always said that Ravi would be a man of honor like his father. Ravi looked suddenly grave. His dark skin seemed even darker. It may be that he regretted his word. Possibly he saw the confusion in Ginny's white brown eyes. In any case, he did not wait for an answer. "Can I offer you a lift to chapel in my 21st birthday present?" he asked, putting his sunglasses back on. She noticed how thick their frames were. Real gold, she thought, like the big fat watch on his wrist. "It's a Mercedes from Papa. Do you like it?" he added nonchalantly. From the shade of her umbrella, Ginny peered up at a small lawn cloud, the hum motionless above them. The sun was beating down mercilessly and there was an urge in the air and an overpowering sense of grout. With a handkerchief, she wiped the sweat from her forehead. Ravi gave a tug at his collar. "It's air-conditioned, Ginny, and you won't be late for chapel," he continued, reading her mind. But chapel must have been the last thing on Ravi's mind when Ginny, after a moment's hesitation, accepted his offer, for he drove her instead to a quiet sugar field outside town, and there, with the Mercedes concealed among the sugar canes, he introduced himself into her. Ginny was in a daze. Young as she was, she barely understood what was happening to her. The beat of calypso filled her ears and the sugar canes towered over her as the cold draught from the air conditioner played against her knees. Afterwards, clutching the ragged flower that had been torn from her hair, she lay among the tall, sweet-smelling canes and sobbed until the brief tropical twilight turned to starry night. But she told no one, not even Father Olivier. 2 weeks later, the little market town of Rio Cristalino was alive with gossip. Ravi Kirjani had been promised the hand of Sunita Murpalani. Like the Kirjanis, the Murpalanis were an established Indian family, one of the wealthiest in the Caribbean. But while the Kirjanis were diplomats, the Murpalanis were a commercial family. They had made their fortune in retailing long before the collapse in oil price had emptied their customers' pockets, and now Murpalani stores were scattered throughout Trinidad and some of the other islands. Prudently, they had diversified into banking and insurance, and as a result, their influence was left of the highest level. It was a benevolent influence, of course, never abused, for people always said the Murpalanis were a respectable family and well above reproach. They had houses in Port of Spain, Tobago and Barbados, as well as in England and India, but their main residence was a magnificent sprawling colonial-style mansion just to the north of Rio Cristalino. The arranged marriage would be the social event of the following year. When Ginny heard Ravi's engagement, the loathing she had conceived for him grew into sort of numb hatred. She was soon haunted by a longing to repay that heartless, arrogant brute. She would give anything to humiliate him, to see that leering, conceited grin wiped from his face, but outwardly she was unmoved. On weekdays she went to school, and on Sundays she went still to Father Olivier's afternoon service. "Girl, you sure does have a lot to confess to that Whitey," her mother would say to her each time she come home late from chapel. "He's not a Whitey, he's a man of God. That as may be, child, but don't forget he does be a man first." The months passed and she did not see Rafi again. And then it rained. All through August, the rain hardly stopped. It rattled persistently on the galvanized roofs until you thought you would go mad with the noise. And if it stopped, the air was as sticky as treacle, and you prayed for it to rain again. Then one day in October, towards the end of the wet season, when Ginny's family were celebrating her only brother's 18th birthday, something happened that she had been dreading for weeks. She was lying in the hammock on the balcony playing with her 6-year-old nephew, Pinny. Suddenly, Pinny cried out, "Ginny, why are you so fat?" Throughout the little frame house, all celebration stopped. On the balcony, curious eyes were turned upon Ginny, and you could see what the boy meant. "God have mercy on you, Virginia. Watch the shape of your belly," cried Mrs. Nairn, exploding with indignation and pulling her daughter indoors, away from the prying neighbor's ears. Her voice was loud and hard, and there was a blackness in her eyes like the blackness of the skies before thunder. How could she have been so blind? She cursed herself for it, and harsh question brushed for her lips. "How does you bring such shame upon us, girl? What worthless layabout does you throw yourself upon? What man have you now? No decent man, that does be sure. And why does you blacken your father's name like this at your age? The man as didn't even live to see you born. Thank the gods he didn't have to know of this. You sure got some explaining to your precious man of God child." At last her words were exhausted, and she sat down heavily, her weak heart pounding dangerously and her chest heaving from the exertion of her outburst. Then Ginny told her mother of the afternoon that Rafi Kirjani had raped her. That was a long silence after that, and all you could hear was Mrs. Nairn wheezing. When at last she spoke, her words were heavy and disjointed. "If anybody have to get damnation, that Kirjani boy'll get it," she said. Ginny's sister were awestruck. "Shall we take her over to the health center, ma?" asked Indra. "The midwife comes today." "Is you crazy, girl? You all just know how that woman does run she mouth like a duck's bottom. You all leave this to me." That night, Mrs. Nairn took her young daughter to see Dr. Khan, an old friend of her husband whose discretion she could count on. There was no doubt about it. The child was pregnant. "And what can us do, Dr. Khan?" asked Mrs. Nairn. "Marry her off, quick as you can," the lean old doctor replied bluntly. Mrs. Nairn scoffed. "Who will take her now, doctor? I just beg you. There's nothing. Nothing you can do for us?" A welcome breeze came through the slats of the surgery windows. Outside, you could hear the shrill, persistent sound of cicadas. While mosquitoes crowded at the screens, attracted by the bare bulb over the simple desk, Dr. Khan sighed and peered over the frames of his glasses. Then he lowered his voice and spoke wearily, like a man who has said the same thing many times. "I might arrange something for the baby once it's born, but it must be born, my dear. Your daughter is slimly built. She's young, a child herself. To you, she looks barely 3 months pregnant. Don't fool yourself. If the date she's given us the correct, in 3 months she'll be full term. Anything now would be too messy." "And if it's born?" asked Mrs. Nairn falteringly. "If it's born, what does happen then?" "No, ma, I want it anyway. I want to keep it," said Ginny quietly. "Don't be fool, child. It's my baby, ma. I want to have it. I want to keep it." "And who's to look after you and pay for the baby? Even if that Kirjani does agrees to pay. Who does you help to marry? I'll marry. Don't worry. You'll marry. You does be full. Who will you marry? Kirjani ma. I is going to marry Rafi Kirjani. Dr. Khan gave a chuckle. So your daughter is not such a fool as you think, he said. I told you to marry her off. And the Kirjani boys were to try. What does she have to lose? She's too clever. So Rafi Kirjani was confronted with the pregnant genie and reminded of that Sunday afternoon in the dry season when the canes were ready for harvesting. To the surprise of the Nareens, he did not argue at all. He offered at once to marry genie. It may be that for him it was a welcome opportunity to escape a connubial arrangement for which he had little appetite. Told Sunita Murpalani indisputably had background. Nobody ever pretended that she had looks, or possibly he foresaw awkward police questions that might have been difficult to answer on the fruit of his desire saw the light of day. Mrs. Nareen was staggered. Even Jeannie was surprised at how little resistance he put up. Perhaps, she thought with a wry smile, he's not really so bad. Whatever his reason, you had to admit Rafi acted honorably. And so did the Child Murpalani family. If privately they felt their humiliation keenly, publicly they bore it with composure, and people were amazed that they remained on speaking terms with the man who had insulted one of their women and broken her heart. Sunita's five brothers even invite Rafi to spend a day with them at their seaside villa in Mayaro. And as Rafi had been a friend of the family all his life, he saw no reason to refuse. The Murpalani brothers chose a Tuesday for the outing. There was little point, they said, in going at the weekend when the working people littered the beach and one of their Land Rovers for the 20-mile drive from Rio Cristalino. They were in high spirit and joked with Rafi while their servants stowed cold chicken and salad beneath the rear bench seat and packed in the icebox with beer and punch and rum. Then they scanned the sky for clouds and congratulated themselves on choosing such of a fine day. Suraj, the eldest brother, looked at his watch and his feet shifted honestly as he said, "It's time to hit the road." His brothers gave a laugh and clambered on board. It was an odd, sardonic laugh. The hardtop Land Rover crashed through Rio Cristalino to the crossroads at the town center. Already the market trades were pitching their roadside stalls and erecting great canvas umbrellas to shield them from sun or rain. The promise of commerce was in the air and the trades looked about expectantly as they loaded their stalls with fresh mango or put the finishing touches to display of giant melons whose flesh pink innards glistened succulently under telephon. The Land Rover turned it towards Mayaro and moment later was passing the cemetery on the edge of town. The road to the coast was busy with traffic in the both directions still carrying produce to market, and the frequent bends and potholes made the journey slow. At last, on the uphill straight about 6 miles from Mayaro, the Land Rover was able to pick up speed. Its ripped tires beat on the reflector stud like a drum roll, and the early morning sun flashed through the coconut palms. Suddenly, a terrible thing happened. The rear door of the Land Rover swung open and Rafi Kirjani tumbled out, falling helplessly beneath the wheel of the heavily laden truck. At the inquest, the coroner acknowledged that the nature and the extent of Ravi's injuries made it impossible to determine whether he was killed instantly by the fall or subsequently by the truck. But it was clear at last he felt that Ravi had been alive when he fell from the Land Rover. The verdict was death due to misadventure. 3 days later, Ravi's remains were cremated. According to Hindu rites, as usual, a crush of people from all over Trinidad, distant relatives, old classmates, anyone claiming even the most tenuous connection with the dead man, come to mourn at the riverside pier outside Mayoro. Some of them were convinced that they could see in Ravi's death the hands of the gods, and they point for evidence to the gray sky and the unseasonal rain, but the flames defied the rain and the stench of burning flesh filled the air. A few spoke darkly of murder. Did not the Marpalanis have a compelling motive? And not by chance did they have the opportunity and the means, but mostly they agreed that it was a tragic accident. It made little difference that it was a Marpalani truck that had finished Ravi off. Marpalani trucks were everywhere. Then they watched as the ashes were thrown into the muddy Otoy River, soon to be lost in the warm water of the Atlantic. "Anyway," said one old mourner with a shrug, "who are we to ask questions?" The police closed their files on the case before the boy was called, and he shook the last of the rain from his umbrella and slapped impatiently at a mosquito. You might have thought that the shock of Ravi's death would have induced in Jenny a premature delivery, but quite the reverse. She attended the inquest and she mourned at the funeral. The expected date came and went. 6 more weeks elapsed before Jenny, by now 13, gave birth to a son at the public maternity hospital in San Fernando. When they saw the baby, the nurse glanced anxiously at each other. Then they took him away without letting Jenny see him. Eventually, they returned with one of the doctors, a big Creole, who assumed his most unruffled, beside manner to reassure Jenny that the baby was well. "It's true, he's a little pasty, my dear," he said as a nurse placed the baby in Jenny's arm. "But you see, that'll be the late delivery, and don't forget you're very young, and you've both had a rough time. Wait a day, 3 days, his eyes'll turn. He'll soon have a healthy color." Jenny looked into her son's blue eyes and kissed them, and in doing so, a tremendous feeling of tiredness suddenly came over her. They were so very, very blue, so like Father Olivier's. She sighed at the irony of it all. The waste of it all. Was the Creole doctor really so stupid? Surely he knew as well as she did that the pallid looks could never go.